Well, it is a great privilege for me to be here with you this morning. And let's go to the Lord in prayer to begin. Father, we come before you in the name of your Son. And we know that we would have no part with you apart from him. Mm-hmm. Lord, we pray that you would give us wisdom and grace and boldness. All the things needed, Lord, to properly communicate your word to your people, to instruct them. And Lord, I pray for those who are here that may not know you, or that may think they know you when they do not. I pray, dear God, we are utterly dependent upon the Holy Spirit. So please, help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I had planned and probably will to take a text in Romans chapter 3. But before I do, let me give you a bit of instruction. The Bakari were mentioned, a people in Iran that are totally and completely unreached. Not only do they not have the gospel, they have no chance hearing the gospel. Now, how hard is your heart? How hard has your heart become as a Christian that you heard that this morning? Did you forget what was said to you right after it was said? Then were you consumed by other prayer requests that also you did not listen to? Be careful of worshiping God by rote. Yeah. Simply going through the motions. We heard something this morning that should lay every one of us in the dust. There's a people group that for 2,000 years possibly never heard the gospel. We quickly jump on to something else, leave the church bulletin behind, and maybe if I'd said nothing, that group would have not been prayed for at all by anyone in this building, because it wasn't prayed for here just now. Do you realize that? Now, I'm not saying that to try to hurt you, and I know I'm a guest, but you called me here to speak to you. Amen. And these are things, someone asked me before I got up to preach, they asked me a question, and I said, I am utterly, for spiritual growth, I'm utterly dependent upon being around other people who are wiser than I, more spiritually mature than I, more on fire than I, or maybe they're at a real height in their life when I'm at a real low, or I'm at a real high when they're at a real low. We need each other, and we need to speak like this to one another. Amen. It's one of the most neglected things, I believe, in all the church. People ask me sometimes, you know, after 35 years of what seems like burning volcanic zeal, how do you keep going? And of course, you know, there's the study of the scriptures, there's prayer. But I have to admit, I think my greatest source are other believers, whether they're dead and I read their biography or I read about their devotion, or saints that I know that every time I'm around them, I'm convicted. I'm even cut. And I always walk away wanting to be more like Christ because of them. So I want to applaud you, because many of the things that I've seen here today, your desire to be biblical, especially in the prayer meeting this morning before the main service. But always realize, man, we were just told something. And being told that thing, I'm now accountable for it. Do you see? And that's very, very important. And another thing about a prayer meeting, one time, only one time, Jesus was asked, teach us to pray. He was asked that. And isn't it amazing that they never asked him, teach us to cast out demons, teach us to walk on water, teach us to heal the sick. That tells me that his prayer life was extraordinary. Yeah. I mean, absolutely extraordinary. And they said, teach us to pray. And he said, pray then in this way, our Father who art in heaven gives us the perfect psychology of prayer. He's our Father. We can approach him in Christ. But our Father is the King of heaven. Amen. So you approach him with reverence. And then he says, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Three petitions, yes and no. It's really like a diamond, has many facets, but it's the same diamond. Those three petitions are all one. They're just three different facets of that petition. Jesus is basically telling us how to pray. I mean, it's the only time he teaches us on this matter. Now, look what he says. After addressing the Father with a proper reverence, what is the first thing? Hallowed be thy name. Now, if you talk to me, the greatest passion inside me is the thing I'm going to talk about first. If you ask me, what do you want? I'm going to tell you the thing I most want. So when Jesus Christ commands his people to pray, what is the first thing that comes out of his mouth? Hallowed be thy name. What does it mean? It means this. He's really saying, holy be your name. Now the word holy has this idea of, it's not like you think. You think immediately when you hear holy, you think sinless. No, that's a derivative. Holy is separate. He's saying, separate be your name. That means that your name not be put in any category with any other person. That your name be considered so high, so esteemed, that there's no competition. There's everything else over here, and then there's God. Amen. And so the greatest passion of his heart when he prayed, the thing that was most important to him over everything else, is that God be esteemed and honored as God. Now, when you have a prayer meeting, is that the first thing that comes up? In your prayer life, is that the first thing that comes up? It's always, for me, it's kind of a standard. Not only of how to pray, but to judge my own heart. Is the greatest passion in my life that God be glorified? Is it the greatest problem in my life that he's not as glorified in me as he ought to be? Is that my greatest burden? Is it my greatest burden that there are places in this world where he's not glorified? And I can't stand it. I can't sleep at night because God is not being honored as God. That's the sign of true spiritual maturity. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. His reign. His government over absolutely everything. I'm not talking about a world human government that's turned into a theonomy. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the present reign of Jesus Christ in heaven, that it would expand over all the earth, and that every person, including myself, would live in total submission to the will of Christ. That's what a church should be praying about every time it opens its mouth. Not only should that be what the church is praying about every time it opens its mouth, but that should be the most important thing to the church. Everything else is secondary. And very, very, very secondary. Nothing competes with this. And then, let's just turn there before we go to Romans. Look really quickly at Matthew 6. Then he says this. Give us this day our daily bread. What's going on here? Daily bread comes after hallowed be your name, your kingdom advance in all the world. You know what it's saying? And listen to me, this is very important. Many preachers have said this, and it's true. Prayer is basically a wartime communication for soldiers. Because when you say, give us this day our daily bread, what you're actually saying is this: give me what I need to do that. Give me the sustenance I need. Why? For one reason. So that I can live my entire life, that your name will be hallowed, your kingdom will come, and your will be done. There's no separation of the two things. It's not, give me bread because I'm hungry. It's not, fix my body because it hurts. It's not this or that or any other thing for me. That's not what it's about. But it's simply this: give me what I need so that I can live according to your calling in my life in 100% devotion and service to you, whether I'm a preacher or a banker or a welder or a carpenter or a housewife. You see, that's why prayer doesn't work in most prayer meetings. Because the whole thing is skewed. The whole thing is wrong from the very foundation up. It's just wrong. Prayer is not a town meeting where you just tell the news. Prayer is a place where your greatest desires are that God's name be treated entirely separate and given the greatest estimation and the greatest reverence. That his government advance in the spread of the gospel throughout the world, and that every soul, including our own, lives in total submission to him. That's what prayer's about. And then it is, I need food to be able to do this. Or I need a place to live in order to do this. Or I need a job in order to do this. Do you see how messed up it gets when it's not that way? Then you also understand how to deal with trials and sickness and poverty and everything else. It goes something like this. For many, many years of my life, I've lived with chronic pain. A pain is always. I never have a moment when there's not pain. It's always. Both hips have been replaced. I mean, they try to just take more and more parts of me and take it out and replace it with something else. Now, here's the way you pray. Lord, I'm hurting. I feel like I'm going to throw up every morning when I wake up. I'm hurting so bad. If by healing me, your name will be revered in a greater way, your kingdom will come in a greater way, your will be done in a greater way, and I will be of greater service to you in those things, then heal me. But if through my suffering and my sickness and my pain and my nausea, you in the end will get greater reverence, your kingdom will more greatly advance, and your will be more devoutly carried out, then leave me here with this thing you have given me. Yea, Lord, even let me die. But let your name be hallowed. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. You see, that's what life is about. How do I know that? Because that's what Christ's life was about. Do you see that? That's what his life was about. And as a matter of fact, if you want to see the heart of Jesus Christ, Yes, there's many places you could go. John 3:16, John 15, so many places. But if you want to know the heart of hearts of Christ, it's Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. You see, very important. Very, very, very important. We must learn to pray right. And we must take it as a very, very serious matter. And you need to hear this. Why? Because I need to hear it. Amen. We all need to hear it all the time. All the time. I am sure that the same weaknesses that dwell in me also dwell in you, at least to some degree. And I constantly need to hear this. You see. All right. Well, let's go to Romans chapter 3. Verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by His grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in His blood through faith. This was to demonstrate His righteousness, because in the forbearance of God He passed over the sins previously committed. For the demonstration, I say, of His righteousness at the present time, so that He would be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? Of works? No, but by a law of faith. Wherever I go in the world, apart from some unusual burden to carry me in some other direction, I made the commitment that I would always preach this text. Why? Many theologians have called this the Acropolis of the Christian faith, the great city, the fortified city of the Christian faith. That this is, many have said, Charles Spurgeon, Martin Lloyd-Jones, that this would be the greatest passage in all the scriptures. And yet so often these big words here are not understood. We need to understand them. Now, literally, we could take this and for the next week go through it, and we wouldn't exhaust it. We wouldn't even come close. But we are just going to, I want to give you a general idea of what's being said here. Now, first of all, verse 23, for all have sinned. You know why that has so little power today when someone says you're a sinner? You know why that has so little power? Because we don't know God. If I handed out a sheet of paper in most churches and said, I want you to write out the attributes of God, most people wouldn't even know where to start. You see, we don't know God. And because of that, sin's not a big issue. That's why it is so important to understand from the scriptures. Jeremiah said that rich men and wise men shouldn't boast in all that, but the one who boasts in this, that he knows God. Amen. And then he goes on to list some of the attributes of God, like righteousness. You see, once you understand God as He's revealed in the scriptures, sin begins to have an impact upon you. You begin to see this is a terrifying thing. As a matter of fact, there's nothing more terrifying than to hear these words, you are a sinner. Amen. You see, if you and I are playing tag football or something and you knock me down by accident and I jump up and say, you do that again, I'm going to take you out of this world. You're just going to laugh about it, and so am I. But if I do that to the President of the United States, I'm going to prison. Why? Because of the office that he holds. Now, all the presidents and kings and monarchs of the world are nothing. And they, included with their nations, they're nothing more than a speck of dust in the scales. We're talking about God. To rebel against him, how terrible is it? One sin, and Adam and Eve were cast out of his presence, and all of creation was thrown into corruption and under a curse. One sin. And yet you, my friend, have sinned more times than probably a calculator could surmise. All have sinned. That's a terrible thing. Now, don't stand back and go, oh, but it's okay because God does hate the sin, but he loves the sinner. Actually, that's not true. That's not what the Bible teaches. Amen. It's a wonderful thing, I guess, to put in poetry and song, but it's error. It's heresy. The Bible never teaches that. As a matter of fact, the Bible teaches that God hates the sinner. It's what the Bible says. Now, you have to understand what it means. Now, it is. It's there. I just want to show it to you. Look quickly in Psalms chapter 5. Because many just won't believe it. Yeah. Psalms 5, 5. Well, let's look at verse 4. Psalms 5, 4. For you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness. No evil dwells with you. The boastful shall not stand before you, your eyes. You hate all who do iniquity. It doesn't say that he hates iniquity, even though he does. He hates unrighteousness. No, it says he hates all who do iniquity. And you said, but I thought God is a God of love. He is, and that's just the point. I thought you said God is good. God is good, and that's just the point. You see, here's the thing. God is love, but you're not. You don't. And so what's a loving God supposed to do with someone like you who doesn't love? You see, God is good, but you're not. Amen. So what does God do with someone like you? You see, we live in a nation that can kill 60 million babies. And we don't even blush. We don't hate evil. God hates evil. The smallest infraction of the law, the smallest deviation of a right intent of the heart, God hates. Why? Because he is so good. Because he is love. Lovelessness he cannot bear. Because he is good, evil he cannot bear. And you and I are guilty of lovelessness and evil. Both. I was teaching at a university in Eastern Europe several years ago. And it was a hostile crowd, I can assure you. And as I was talking about the holiness of God, this young man jumps up and basically says, I'm sick and tired of your Puritan God with all his restrictive rules. All you want to do is just shut us down and stunt us and take away our freedom. You're God in all your laws. So I said, okay, fair enough. Let's have a conversation, you and I, in front of this auditorium. Which one of these laws suppress you? Is it the one who says you shall not lie? Does that kind of hinder the way you want to live? Well, what does that say about you? And is it the one that says do not take another man's wife? Is that the one that's suppressing you? I said, let's continue. Let's just go on through all the laws and see which one is so bad and harmful to you. And in the end, the man was ashamed, and he should have been. And then he says, well, we just want to go out and party, that's all. We're not hurting anybody. Oh, really? So who, you and the guys sitting around you, you want to go party tonight, right? Okay. What does that mean? So you're going to go out trolling for girls, and you're going to try to have some sort of a relationship with a girl tonight without any commitment whatsoever. What's wrong with that? I wonder how our father feels about that. And you're like a beast, an animal. That could take something precious to another man, consume it, and wipe your face like you've done nothing wrong. You see? You see, the world makes sin look like freedom, makes sin look like something good. And the fact is, it's bondage and it's evil, and it turns human beings into beasts. Who troll for other human beings. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Now, I know what that means in modern day evangelicalism, but modern day evangelicals are wrong. They sit there and say, oh, it means God has a wonderful plan for your life. No, it's not what it means. This text, when it talks about you were made for the glory of God, is not saying that God has a wonderful plan for your life and is working so that you can have that wonderful plan. What it's saying is you were made for God. You were not made for yourself. You were made for Him. And you will continue to be absolutely miserable, defunct, tortured, twisted, out of place, dislocated, until you realize you were made for Him. You weren't made for you. You were made for Him. And you can only be complete in Him. And that goes along, young lady, young men, with regard to marriage. I hear all these teachers saying, your husband completes you. Your wife completes you. If your husband or your wife can complete you, you're not a Christian. The only one who can truly satisfy that new heart of yours is Jesus Christ. Because your husband and wife will fail you. And if you think that failure means you picked the wrong mate, you're in trouble. You were made for Him. Have you ever noticed these people who literally have inherited the world? Are they any more happy? No, many of them end their life in suicide. And drunkenness and drugs. Why? Because the world can actually do nothing for you. I always talk to my wife, and we talk about when we started. We had nothing. I mean, I didn't even buy her an engagement ring until 2 years after we were married. And then it was service merchandise for like $223. And we've lived in some bad places, even in the jungle, in tents and all kinds of things. And my question to her is, okay, we have a little cabin now. We live out in the woods and all these different things. Are we any happier than when we were in the tent? I finally bought you a wedding ring, a real one, like our 20th anniversary, I think. But are you any happier with that than you were when you had nothing? And the answer is always no. You see, there's only one thing that can truly make us satisfied, and that is God. We were made for Him. Now, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and because of that, all men are condemned and under the wrath of God. By your own works, by your own deeds, by the thoughts of your heart, by everything you can produce, you are only condemned. And this is why God does what He does. For example, in verses 10 through 18 in chapter 3. Look at all the things He's saying. There's none righteous. There's none good. There's none who seek after Me. Why is He doing that? There's no fear of God before their eyes. Why is He saying that? He's saying that to awaken you to the fact that you need redemption. You need to be saved. You must be saved. When a preacher who has a correct heart and a correct theology begins to preach sermon after sermon on your sin, it's not that he's trying to destroy you. He's trying to save you from destruction. You're already on the path of destruction. And he's trying to convince you of that fact so that you'll turn to the only hope that is Jesus Christ, the grace of God revealed in Jesus Christ. My mother, who has gone on to be with the Lord, she was a very strong woman and very stubborn. And when she got cancer, the doctor knew that she would not get treatment. So I'll never forget that doctor walking in, and he had a portfolio. I mean, he had a stack of envelopes and papers and examinations probably this high. And he sat down in front of my mother and he said, "You have cancer. Evidence number one. You need treatment. Evidence number two. Evidence number three. Evidence number four. Evidence number five." Because he knew he had to convince this elderly woman of her desperate need. And so he presented evidence after evidence after evidence until her will gave way. And that's what the Apostle Paul is doing. That's what the prophets did. That's what this whole book is about. It is pointing out our sin. You have sinned. You have sinned. You have sinned. You cannot save yourself. You cannot save yourself. There's only one hope. Look up to God. To God in Christ, to what God has done for you on the cross of Calvary. Look at verse 19. "Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God." What is the purpose of the law? To shut your mouth and to shut mine. To shut it of its boasting. Boasting in what? If I'm not a betting man, but I would assume that if we were to dismiss right now and divide up every home in this county, and we went to every home in this county, and we asked people, are you going to go to heaven when you die? The great majority of people would say yes, and the great majority of people would tell you the reason why. They're good. I'm good. I never killed anybody. I'm a good guy. That's the open mouth boasting. I work a lot of times. I go to two different universities sometimes every week and teach the gospel. And I'm surprised how many students will come in who are not antagonistic, very nice, very polite, were raised in church. And the great majority of them are believing that somehow they're saving themselves through morality. Yeah. It's absolutely astounding. Or Jesus and morality. But if it's Jesus and anything else, you're not a Christian. If your boast is Jesus plus something else, you are not a Christian. If I died right now, I would go to heaven. Why? 2,000 years ago, the Son of God died for this sinner. Nothing more than that and nothing less is my boast. Christ died for sinners. Martin Lloyd-Jones, possibly one of the greatest preachers, definitely greatest expositor of the 20th century, and also known. One time he went to visit a friend in the hospital, and he visited his friend, and after he left, people came up to his friend who was in the hospital and says, "I have to know, who was that clean man?" He was known for his extraordinary godliness and piety. Some call him the last of the Puritans. The last couple of weeks of his life, everybody who visited him, the only thing he said was this: "I am a great sinner, and Christ is a great Savior." If there's anything added to that, you're not a Christian. You're not. If it's church attendance, good works, orphanages, I don't care what it is, you're not a Christian. The Christian has one hope. Jesus Christ died and rose again for the dead, from the dead, and his work is perfect.
Amen.
On my behalf. He did it for me, for me, for me. Mm-hmm. Now, he goes on, and after saying what he says in verse 23, he's now going to talk about the Roman Christians. And this is magnificent what he says. He says, being justified. Now, what does justified mean? I've heard some preachers say, just as if I'd never sinned. No, that's not what it means. Justification is a forensic or legal term. It's a legal term. It means that before the judgment throne of God. Now listen to my terminology. It's very important. Before the judgment throne of God, God looks at you and declares you to be legally right with him. And then he treats you as right with him. Justification is when the sinner, before the throne of God, is legally right with God, and God treats that sinner as right with him. Okay? God declares the sinner to be right with him. Do you understand that? Now let's go on. He says, being justified as a gift by his grace. Now, this declaration of being right with God, it's a gift by his grace, which basically Paul is saying it's a gift, it's a gift, it's a gift, it's a gift, it's a gift. Now, if you ever study theology and you have to study a comparative religions class where you compare all sorts of religions, you want to take my class. Trust me. Because there are thousands and thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of religions. So you want to take my class. Why? Because I tell you, there's only two religions in the whole world. Christianity and every other religion. You say, well, that's, you're pretty proud. No, it's a fact. Even if you don't agree with Christianity, you have to recognize that Christianity is distinct from every other religion in the world. In what way? In all the other religions in the world, you are trying to do something in order to earn the favor of the deity. You're thinking he has a scale up there, and if you have more good than bad, you're going to get in. That's every religion in the world. It's a religion of works. Amen. Only Christianity is a religion of grace. Amen. Now, I've used this illustration in countless places in countless parts of the world, but it always seems to communicate truth to people. If I have an Orthodox Jew standing here, and I'm a reporter, and I say, sir, if you died right now, where would you go? He'd say, I'd go to the way of paradise. I'd go to heaven. Why? Because I love the Torah. I love the law. I love the law of God. I read the law of God. I seek to obey the law of God. Okay. If I have a Muslim standing here, and I said, sir, if you died right now, where would you go? I would go to paradise. Why would you go to paradise? I love the Quran. I've made the pilgrimages. I've completed the five pillars. I am a good man. Okay? I go to the Christian, the real one, a real Christian, which I'm not talking about most people who call themselves Christians in America. I'm talking about a real Christian. Not some person who simply one time got manipulated to raise their hand in a camp meeting. Yeah. I'm not talking about someone who just repeated a prayer one time. I'm talking about someone who truly repented of their sins and believed the gospel and continue unto this day repenting and believing. Amen. And being transformed. I walk up to him. I said, sir, if you died right now, where would you go? And he said, I'd go to heaven. When I ask him, why? He says this, I was born in sin. And I have come forth sinning from the womb. I have broken every law of my God. And I stop him. I go, sir, I don't understand. I mean, I understand the other two guys. They're going to go to heaven because God owes them. They're going to go to heaven because they deserve it. They're going to go to heaven because they have virtue and merit. Sir, you're telling me you're going to heaven and you have no virtue and merit. How are you going to heaven? And the Christian smiles, I'm going to heaven upon the virtue and the merit of another Jesus Christ, my Lord. Amen. That's the difference. That it is all of grace. My best moment as a Christian now of 35 years, of having at times even put my life in great danger for the sake of the gospel, in my greatest moment of piety in 35 years, that greatest moment of piety and good work would only earn me hell. Amen. We are saved if we are saved for the same reason that thief was saved. Jesus Christ died for sinners. Yes. Amen. That's it. And if you have any other boast or any other addition, you're not a Christian. And you need to know that. Now, being justified as a gift by His grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in His blood through faith. Now, what I've said thus far creates a great problem. And I want you to understand this. If you get nothing of what I've said today, please don't miss this. I'm going to share with you the greatest problem in all the Scripture. As a matter of fact, it's what all the Scripture is written about. It is the central theme, and most Christians have never even heard it. And it's not that they haven't heard it because I invented it. If you go back and read 2,000 years of Christian theology, you will find that whenever Christianity is biblical, this is the center point of all preaching. And yet it's not the center point of preaching today. And it's why people don't understand the gospel. And what is it? Here's the problem. Now listen to me. If God is good, He cannot forgive you. If God is holy and righteous, He cannot forgive you. And the great question in the entire Bible is this: how can a God who is holy, a judge that is righteous, pardon the criminal when the very law of that God, of that judge, demands that that criminal die? Now, I'm going to show you the problem, okay? I want you to see. And now, come on now. If you're a youngster and you never pay attention to a sermon, you'd do well to pay attention right now, because maybe your whole, well, the entirety of your existence may be hanging in a balance.
Amen.
Look in Exodus 34. And we're going to look at what seems to be a great contradiction, and would be a contradiction if it weren't for what comes. Now, Exodus 34, verse 5. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood there with him, that is Moses, as he called upon the name of the Lord. This is one of the greatest manifestations of God in the entire Bible. In the Old Testament, the two biggies are here and Isaiah 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple, and above him stood the seraphim, each one having six wings. This is just as big as that. Now, then the Lord, verse 6, passed by in front of him and proclaimed, the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness and truth, who keeps loving kindness for thousands. Wow, it's an amazing God. He's so compassionate, so loving. And then, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin. Now, this is something of a Hebrew parallelism. You see, when in the Hebrew language, when they want to emphasize something, they repeat it. Holy, holy, holy. Or what they'll do is they'll say a term and then say another term that is similar to it that helps define that term, and then say another term that helps define it. It's called a Hebrew parallelism. Let me give you an example. In the book of Proverbs, you know, let me make up a proverb for you. The wicked shall not dwell in the land, the wicked shall be destroyed. I'm saying the same thing twice. The second time I say it is a little bit different to add to the meaning of the first phrase. So when he says that he forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin, what he's trying to say is this: he forgives every type and kind of sin. Because he's a compassionate God, because he's full of loving kindness, because he's slow to anger, he forgives every type and kind of sin. Okay, so far so good. No contradiction. Now read. And yet he will by no means leave the guilty unpunished. Do you see the problem? He says, I forgive every type and kind of sin, but I'm going to punish everybody who commits any type or kind of sin. Do you see that? Do you see what he's saying? It appears to be a contradiction. God is saying he forgives all sin, and then he says, I'm going to punish every sinner for their sin. That's what it says. That's what it says. Now, let's go and go to Proverbs 17. And let's look at it from another angle. Proverbs 17:15. He who justifies the wicked and he who condemns the righteous, both of them alike are an abomination to the Lord. Now look at what it's saying. Whoever justifies a wicked person is an abomination to God. And yet what does God do? He justifies wicked people. So has God become an abomination? So let's look at our two contradictions, our apparent contradictions. Number one, God says he forgives all types and kinds of sin, but that he will punish every sinner for every sin they commit. And then it says this, whoever justifies a wicked man is an abomination to God, and yet the book of Romans is all about God justifying wicked men. So how can God justify wicked men without becoming an abomination? How can he forgive all sin and at the same time punish all sin? That seems to be an absolute contradiction. Okay? Let me show you how important this is. This is probably a small town. Let's say that you go home after work one day and someone has killed your entire family. Murdered them with his bare hands. And when you walk through the door, that murderer is standing there wringing the life out of your last child. You control yourself, but you run across the room, you throw the murderer to the ground, you tie him up, and you call the police. The police take him away. Everybody in the town hears about it. Now it's time for this murderer to go to court. So he is brought into the courtroom. The judge is there on the bench. Everybody knows you, loves your family. And the judge says this. He looks down at the criminal and he says, I'm slow to anger, compassionate, abounding in loving kindness. You're free to go. I justify you. I declare you innocent. What are you going to do? Are you going to go, wow, that was wonderful? No, you're going to be furious, and rightly so. You're going to call the newspaper. You're going to call the media. You're going to write senators and congressmen. You're going to try to get a hold of the president. You're going to say, there is a judge on the bench far more wicked than the criminals he pardons. A judge is supposed to do justice. Well, is not the God of all the earth supposed to do justice? And if he doesn't do justice, is he God? You see, here's what you need to understand. This is one of the reasons why it's so important to study the attributes of God. I have heard evangelists say this. Instead of being just with you, God was loving. Really? That means, logically, that God's love is unjust. Really? That's the problem we have in the world today, all this unrighteous love going on. No, God cannot deny his righteousness even for the sake of his love. He cannot deny his holiness even for the sake of his mercy. God must be holy and righteous even when he acts with mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. And therein is the problem. How can God do both? Now let's go back to Romans chapter 3. I want to look at 25 and then we'll come back to 24. God uses a word here. It says, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation. Now, what is a propitiation? This word is important. It's extremely important, and maybe the most important word in the entire Bible. What does it mean? In the context of the scriptures, the word is referring to a sacrifice that satisfies divine justice. so that God may be both just and the justifier of wicked men. Do you see that? Now, let's go back to our doctrine of justification. What does it mean? If you're a Christian, you are justified. Okay? Justified means that God declares you to be legally right with Him, and He treats you as someone legally right with Him. Now, I want you to think about this. It's very important. If you have one sin, only one sin, you're guilty before God as Adam was guilty before God, and God has no fellowship with you. Do you understand that? Sitting on a plane one time, I had my New Testament out in Greek. I always open up my Greek New Testament on a plane because people get curious and want to know, what are you reading? Is that Russian? What is that? And this, I start a conversation with the guy. And the guy says, okay, so what do I have to do to go to heaven? And I said, oh, that's easy. You have to be absolutely perfect from the moment of your birth to the moment of your death. And I just went back reading. And I just saw his face out of the corner of my eye. He's like, and he goes, I'm sorry, I don't think I understood you. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't. Okay, look, in order to go to heaven, you must be morally perfect without spot or blemish in any shape, form, or fashion to any degree. You must be morally perfect from the moment of birth to the moment of death. And I just went back to reading again. And he goes, well, if it's like that, nobody's going to heaven. I go, yeah, you got a big problem, don't you? Now, why was I playing with him? I wasn't playing with him. But he had this idea that he was a moral man. And I had to make him see, among men you may be moral, but God is absolute righteousness. And before Him, all your good works are like filthy rags, and you yourself are corruption. You see? So when I say justified, think about this, believer, how marvelous this is. When the Bible says you're justified before God, it means God has legally declared you to be perfect. Your position before God will not be more perfect in heaven than it is right now. Amen. Now, you will be transformed, but as far as your position before God, it's legally perfect. Amen. And not only is it legally perfect, but He treats you as though your position was legally perfect. And why is that important? Even when God disciplines you for sin, it is not out of wrath. It is out of love. Amen. That's amazing. I mean, you get your mind around that, it will set you free. Amen. All right? But here's the question. How can God legally declare you to be right with Him and treat you as right with Him? How can He do that if He's righteous? Because on the cross, all your sin was placed upon Christ. And God declared Christ to be legally guilty and treated Him as guilty. How did He treat Him as guilty? He crushed Him under the full force of His holy hatred for evil. All the wrath of God that should fall upon you throughout all eternity fell upon God's Son. And when He cried out, "It is finished," it meant He paid. Yeah. He paid in such a way that justice now looks at you who believes in Him. Justice looks at you and smiles. Justice looks at you and is perfectly satisfied. Because justice has been satisfied through the suffering and death of the sin-bearing substitute, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Imagine you owe somebody an amount of money you could never pay, and they're looking for you in the streets to throw you in prison. Every time you see that person coming toward you, what are you going to do? You're going to dark down an alley. You're going to hide. You're going to be trembling. You're going to be frightened, always thinking it's about to get you. But then one day someone interposes, someone stands in your place and says to justice, or says to this person, how much does so-and-so owe you? $10,000. Here. Paid in full. So now when you walk down the street and you see that person coming, he walks up to you and says, "Hey, how's it going?" He's perfectly satisfied with you. Why? Everything has been paid. The justice of God walking down the street looking for you to condemn you because you owe a debt you cannot pay except an eternity in hell. And you hide and you're scared and you try to block it out of your mind. But Jesus Christ paid that debt. And when you trust in Him, then the justice of God walks up to you and embraces you with a smile. Why? He's fully satisfied. All the wrath of God that should have been poured out on God's people was poured out on the Son. And when He said, "It is finished," it means paid in full. I owe nothing to God. He died for my past sins. He died for my present sins. He died for my future sins. He died for all my sins. I am right with God. I am right before the throne of God. Why? Because Christ bore my sin and was judged in my place. Now, remember what we saw in the book of Exodus, that He forgives all types and kinds of sin, but He will punish every guilty person? He will. There are two ways that the sin of man is punished. For those who trust in Christ, your sins were punished on Calvary. For those of you who refuse to trust in Christ or trust in your morality, your sins will be paid as you spend an eternity in hell. So God is compassionate, abounding in loving kindness, forgives all types and kinds of sin, but only in His Son. He will punish every sin. He has punished the sins of His people in the cross of Christ. He will punish the sins of those who refused through an eternity in hell. And that's what I want you to see. This is what it's all about. And you say, "Well, what must I do?" You must repent and believe the gospel. Amen. You must acknowledge your sin and believe the gospel. Now let's go on quickly because I want to bring up a very important point. Look what he says in verse 24, and then I'm going to go back to 25. It says, "Being justified as a gift by His grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus." The Bible uses several different terms to describe the cross event. One is a propitiation, that Christ died as a sacrifice to satisfy the demands of justice. But another word that is used is also redemption that we have here, and it is a beautiful picture. Redemption is when a payment is made in order to liberate a criminal or a slave or a captive. A price was paid for you. And it wasn't paid to the devil.
Yeah.
It was paid to God.
Amen.
You see, here's what you need to understand. God was against you. You won't hear that much, but it's true. Although God is love, your sin inflamed His righteousness, His holiness, provoked His judgment, because He is a holy and a good God. Do you see that? When Christ died on that tree, He saved you from God. in the sense that he saved you from the wrath of God. Do you see that? Don't worry about the devil. Worry about God. The wrath of God against the sinner. And then rejoice that that wrath was appeased because justice was fully satisfied through the death of Jesus Christ our Lord. Do you see that? Redemption. In my presence, please don't ever sling that word around. We've been redeemed. Don't do that. Don't do that. The Puritans used to say that there are some terms that we should only use with a trembling lip. Because what did it take to pay for you and me? The blood of the Son of God. One of the things I try to convince my children of, to show them in my life, is this. I am not necessarily a religious man. I am not that much of a cultured man. I was raised on a farm hunting and fishing, and that's who I am. I am not about being religious. I'm not about being tidy. I'm not about being cultured. I am this. I am a sinner, a wicked sinner who one day saw that God loved him so much. He sent his Son to die for him, and that's what controls my life. Not the desire to be proper or neat or moral or applauded. No, I'm a prisoner. To what? That God would love a wretch like me to such a degree that he would send his Son to die for me. That's all I care about. Amen. Nothing else. I want them to see it's all about that one thing. Amen. Why do you serve him? Because he died for you. He redeemed you. Sometimes when my boys, you know, were getting into the teenage years and they would say something from the scripture or something, but say it in too light a manner, boy, I'd turn them around and just look them in the face and say, boy, you're talking about the one who died for your father. You're talking about the one for whom your father will die. Don't do that again. Mm-hmm. Yes, Dad, I'm sorry. It's not about religion. It's not about rule keeping. It's about the loyalty to the one who died for this wretch. That's what it is. You see that? And when I talk to you about living right and doing things rightly, I don't care if you're neat and tidy and this or that or anything else or respectful or cultured. It's about loyalty to the one who died for you. He redeemed you. And then look what he says here. He says, is a propitiation in his blood through faith. Now look at this. It's very interesting. Most people don't understand this part. They've never even heard it. But I want you to realize it. Why did God send his Son to die? To save us. But also look what it says, whom God displayed publicly. He displayed his Son on a cross publicly in the religious center of the universe. Why did he do it? It says this was to demonstrate his righteousness, to prove that God was righteous, to show everybody in the world and all of heaven that God is righteous. That's why the Son of God died, to show the world that God is truly righteous. Now, why would he have to prove that? Because in the forbearance of God, he passed over the sins previously committed. What does that mean? I want you to think about this for a moment. We know so little about Satan, but we know that he is a real and fallen being. We understand something of the fact that he rebelled against God and perfect justice was administered to him. Perfect justice. And it seems the moment he fell, perfect justice was administered to him. So then we have Adam and Eve. And God says, you eat of this tree, you will die. They ate. And they died. I believe sense of a spiritual death and leading into a physical death. But there's a promise given. Genesis 3:15. It's called in Latin the Proto-Evangelicum, the first gospel, in which God promises redemption, that he would send someone born of woman who would crush the serpent's head. That presents a problem. Can you imagine Satan, the accuser, not only of the brethren, but of God? What is this, God? I thought you were righteous. They've sinned. They must die. Condemnation, no hope, swift judgment now. Where's your righteousness? And then Noah. Can you imagine Satan on that day? You know what the problem is? Noah should have died. Noah was a sinner. He should have died in the flood also, but God spares him. Imagine Satan. What about Noah? He should have died with the rest of them. You spared him. Where's your righteousness? Oh, Abraham, your friend, he doubted you. He lied about his wife. He didn't believe you. He put her in jeopardy. He's a sinner. He deserves to die. Oh, Israel, they worshiped me in the desert. They didn't worship you. You should have killed them all. Where is your righteousness? Oh, David, King David, your little King David, a man after your own heart. You call him a son. He's a murderer and an adulterer, and he should have died. And on the accusations. Where's your righteousness? Where's your righteousness? How, if you are righteous, how can you forgive these? How can you do that? 2,000 years ago, a council was called. Now, I'm just being dramatic here, but so that you would understand. Imagine Satan standing before the throne of God. Come forward. Do you want to know how I can give a promise to the first fallen parents of humanity? Do you want to know how I could save Noah from that flood? Do you want to know how I could take Abraham and make him a father of many nations and call him my friend? Oh, you want to know about David? How I could forgive him all his transgressions and cleanse his heart and make it white as snow? You want to know how I could do all that and still be just? Look now to Calvary. Because there my son dies under the punishment of all of them. Do you see that? When you look at the cross, you don't just see the greatest demonstration of the love of God. You see the greatest demonstration of the righteousness of God. Amen. He really is who he says he is. He hates sin and he will come with a terrible wrath against it. And on Calvary, that wrath fell upon his son.
Amen.
I hear so, very rarely do I have hear an Easter sermon that just doesn't make me furious. And I'll tell you why. They'll talk about the beatings on Christ's back. They'll talk about the nails in his hands, the crown of thorns, the spear piercing his side, and they'll miss the main point of everything. If you're a Christian, you're not redeemed just because the Romans beat up Jesus. You're redeemed because on that cross, your sin was imputed to the perfect Son of God, and all the wrath of Almighty God that swallows up worlds was poured out on him. He was forsaken and crushed under the condemnation of a righteous God. Ela, ela, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? Because at that moment, he became the worm. He became the serpent lifted up in the wilderness. He became sin on our behalf. Those 3 hours of darkness, I do not believe in any shape, form, or fashion were 3 hours of a cloudy day. I believe it was just like what happened in Egypt. If a man would put his hand before his face, he couldn't see it. Why? For this reason. Christ was shut up in a room where he could not even receive compassion from the women mourning on the hill. No consolation. Bearing our sin like the scapegoat. And then for 3 hours, billows upon billows upon billows of the fierce wrath of God poured out on him until justice was satisfied for all the wickedness that you and I have done. Many theologians, and I am one of them, believe that no one ever, not angel, not man, no matter how long we're ever in eternity, will ever understand or comprehend the suffering of the Son of God those 3 hours when he was shut up to the wrath of Almighty God. Now, honestly, after this great work of redemption, you actually, if God did all this to his Son, do you honestly think there is some way to save yourself by your works? Do you honestly think that what he did was not sufficient, so you have to add your works to it, to boast in them? No. Look what he says in verse 27. After saying all this, Paul says, where then is boasting? Remember in verse 19, the law speaks to shut up everyone's mouth. Well, I want to tell you something. If the law will shut your mouth, and it should, how much more the Son of God dying on a tree should shut your mouth? Shut up all boasting. If he had to give his Son in that way for me to be saved, what kind of sinner was I? You see, people will say, we preach to them the law, and that is true, so that they might see their sin. And that is true. But how much more should we see our sin in the cross of Christ? How great was our sin if the Son of God had to die that way in our place? How great was it? And yet, the death of death and the death of Christ, the end of sin, the end of the accusation of the law, all when he cried out, it is finished. Amen. Where's our boast? He says, where then is boasting? It is excluded. It's shut up. It's shut out. It's nailed down. It's put in a hole. It's covered up. There is no boasting. By what kind of law? None. By works? No. Then how are we to be saved? By renouncing all our trust in everything that has to do with our religion and our self-righteousness and our good works and our morality, renouncing it. That's why the writer of Hebrews talks about repentance from good works. He's not saying we shouldn't do good works. He's saying we are to repent from trusting in good works. Amen. And trust exclusively, uniquely, only, completely in what the Son of God did for us on that tree. And if you say you do, there will be a change, and then there will be ongoing change in your life. You cannot behold him with eyes of faith and truly see him and want to remain in your sin.
Amen.
And want to remain in this world. Yes, sin will still pull at you. You will not be perfected until glory. Yes, you will have to battle with the world. And sometimes you will fall. But you will battle. And you will hate yourself every time you find yourself desiring something more than Christ. You see, are you there? Have you repented of your sins? Have you believed? Now, I want to finish by saying this one thing. Repentance. What does it mean? Metanoeo. Change of mind. Sounds superficial, doesn't it? Repentance means you just change your mind? Yeah, it does. Well, how does that have any impact? In the Bible, the mind, the heart, it's the control center of everything you are, of your will, your emotions, your volition, everything. You can't have your mind change without everything else starting to change. Let me give an example. You're seated in this church right now, and let me say this beforehand. There is no fire in this building. This is an illustration. But you're seated here right now, calmly seated, Not thinking, not panicking, not thinking of jumping up, running, jumping through a window, nothing. Why? Because you think this building is not on fire. And it's not. But you think this building is not on fire. So you're sitting here, your children are in your arms, you're happy, you're content. But if in 1 second your mind changed and you thought this building was being consumed in flames, what would happen? Your emotions would change. Your desires would change. Your will would change. Your actions would change. Everything would change, wouldn't it? So don't tell me that you think Jesus is the Son of God, that he died on a tree in the way I described, and that you really think that, if that really has no impact on your life.
Amen.
Trust me. Imagine this, the Apostle Paul, he leaves Jerusalem headed to Damascus, okay? Why? He thinks that Jesus of Nazareth is the greatest blasphemer and false prophet in the history of Israel. And he hates him. He thinks that Christians are the scum of the earth and should die. That's what Saul of Tarsus believes when he leaves Jerusalem for Damascus. He thinks that and he's acting on it. It's a reality to him. What happens? Before he gets to Damascus, he has an encounter with the risen Son of God. And what happened? His mind changed. He realized at that moment, it was like a Matrix moment. He realized at that moment he was wrong about absolutely everything that mattered. Everything. He was wrong about everything. He believed Jesus was the greatest false prophet in the history of Israel, only to realize that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and the Messiah and the Savior of Israel. He believed that Christians were the scum of the earth that ought to be killed, stamped out, only to realize that he himself was persecuting God's people. His mind changed, and so did everything else. When he got to Damascus, he started preaching and suffering for Christ. Now imagine this, a businessman, super wealthy. He's all about himself. He's all about his appearance. He's all about his company, his business, his cars, his house, his reputation, everything. It's what he lives for. Vacations, everything. But every day when he goes to his office, there's this raggedy old preacher that's out on the sidewalk preaching the gospel. And he hates him. Because it doesn't look classy. It doesn't look cultured around his building. There's nothing he can do about it. He cusses him and walks in the building. But one day, for just a second, something the man says catches him. And he goes, "Come to my office. I want to talk to you." The preacher sits in front of him, begins to share the gospel. And at that moment, that man realizes he thought he was a success. He now realizes that his entire life is an abject failure. He thought he knew what life was about. He realized that his whole life has been wrong. And he trusts in Christ. It doesn't necessarily mean he stops being a businessman. But it does mean this, that now everything in his life is orientated toward Christ, the glory of God, and the service of God's people. Amen. Imagine this. A young girl, she's 16 years old, she's beautiful, and she knows it. She goes to high school every day, all the guys are looking at her, all the girls want to be like her, she is the top of the top. And every day, her and her other cutesy friends walk by this one plain-looking girl sitting over by herself in the cafeteria who's reading her Bible. They laugh at her, they mock her, they call her everything, prude, four eyes, this, that, everything. And then what happens? One day, this beauty, who could hardly stop looking in the mirror, thinks more about her clothes and being like somebody from Hollywood or some girl in a rock show. It's all she thinks about is vanity and boys and nails and hair and mirrors. And she just notices something about the girl. She even sits down thinking she's going to mock her. "So what's this Christianity about, Mother Teresa?" And the little girl shares the gospel. And that girl realizes she's wrong about everything. that she's wrong about everything, that her beauty may last possibly 5 or 10 more years before it goes down the drain. That her popularity, she's like an animal, a huntress, a beast. She has no virtue, no morality, no nothing. She's just dark and dirty and filthy inside. She sees she's been wrong about everything. And she trusts in Christ. And that little girl becomes her best friend. That's repentance. And oh, there'll be struggles for the businessman. Sometimes, oh, he's gotten back in it too much and he realizes that the Holy Spirit won't let him go. And so he gets back to what's right again. And sometimes that girl, at least at first, falls back into her vanity and at times, but she's struggling through it because he who began a good work in her will finish it. Do you see that? That's repentance. And what is faith? Faith is believing what God said about his son. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son. Whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. I believe. I believe in him. I have no hope. I can honestly survey my life. I can do this before you right now. I can honestly survey my life. I can look at my deeds. I can look at my religiosity. I can look at my devotion. I can look at the orphanages. I can look at the missionaries we supported. Everything. And I look at all of them. I could do it for days, years. And in the end of my survey, I will find not one thing that will make me right before God.
Amen.
But only that which will condemn me. I have only one hope. Jesus Christ died for sinners. And he delights in saving them.
Amen.
He really does. I know I've gone too long, but let me finish with one of my favorite things from Spurgeon. Now, we don't know if this is true, but Spurgeon is Spurgeon. He was a imaginative fellow, very biblical, but he could really illustrate something. Think about that thief. He's on the cross, and Jesus looks at him and says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." People always ask the question, where did Jesus go when he died? He went to paradise. He went to heaven. He told the thief, "Today you'll be with me there." So, now, this isn't the bodily resurrection in which he goes in as the man Christ Jesus, but he, after his death, he committed his spirit to God. This is one of the greatest moments in redemptive history. The doors of heaven open, and there stands the Son, the victor. I mean, it's like the big moment, right? Angels fall on their faces, worship, the saints of the Old Testament, all worshiping. And there he is. And then imagine this. An angel looks up and goes, "Who's that? Who? I mean, in this moment of moments, who is this honored one who is accompanying our Lord? Is it a prophet? Is it a martyr? Is it one of the greats of the Old Testament?" Thief looks up and goes, "Hi, I'm Ed, the thief." I mean, think about this for a moment. The person who in all of history had less to hope in, who had nothing. He died on a tree. He had no works. He didn't come down. He didn't take care of orphans. He nothing. And yet he's the one that accompanies Christ in his great entrance. You know what Spurgeon said? He goes, "That was a sign to all of us sinners."
Yeah.
That this is the very reason Christ died. To save sinners. And not just save them. But save them in a very large way. But only in Christ. And I plead with you today. Turn from your foolishness. Because all sin is foolishness. Turn from your gross exaltation of yourself. Realize all that's wrong and throw yourself on Christ. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Most of all, thank you for your Son and the word that shows him to us and the Spirit illuminates our mind. In Jesus' name, amen.